this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. We stand to sing, I bow to thee, my country. To St. Helen's, here where we gather, and welcome to those of you who are online watching this in the present moment, or perhaps online afterwards, as I know some of you do. This morning, we gather in the presence of Almighty God, whose purposes are always good, whose power sustains the world he has made, who loves us, though we have failed in his service, who is in his unique Son, Jesus Christ, offers life to the world, who by his Holy Spirit leads all who put their faith in him. We offer him praise and thanksgiving for our nation's deliverance in times of war, to recall to our minds those who through death, injury or bereavement suffered to bring peace and freedom to our world, to seek his forgiveness for our failure to achieve reconciliation between the nations, and to ask for strength to overcome evil and injustice wherever it is found. And so, mindful of damage that conflict brings in every area of our life, let us begin by confessing our share in what is wrong and our failure to seek and establish that peace which God wills for his children. So if you would you sit or kneel as is most appropriate for you. We pray together. We confess to you, Lord God, our sins and shortcomings, our pride, selfishness and greed, our divisions and hatreds. We confess our share in what is wrong, and our failure to seek and build peace in still you will for us. Help us to act justly, love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare to hear the promises of Christ's holy word, let us stand to sing, Our God, our help in ages past.
Testament reading from Malachi chapter 4 verses 1 to 4. Surely the day is coming. It will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble, and the day that is coming will set them on fire, said the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them, but for you who revere my name, the sun of the righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. You will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. Then you will trample on the wicked. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, said the Lord Almighty. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws I gave him at Horeb. For all Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4. Verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, whatever is true, whatever is honourable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we pray that the words of our mouth would be honouring to you. We pray that through the preaching and explaining of God's word, we may enter closer into your peace that is offered to us. Amen. It might seem like an obvious place to start. But on Remembrance Sunday, we gather to remember. We gather to remember by calling to mind the horrors of war, the price that it exacts on soldiers, on families. What is there to say when humanity is swallowed up, when life is taken, when life is maimed? Hearts and minds are scarred by horror and loss. Nightmares speak and words fail. Evil and injustice spill out in loss to assault families fragmented. Those that fight come home in boxes. Some come home alive and yet haunted. We owe a debt of honour and a debt of thanks to those who fight for our freedom, both to those that have died and given the ultimate price, the ultimate sacrifice, but also to those that live on, to those who return home and yet are not the same. And perhaps less obviously, we owe a degree of pity for those who are deceived and those who are dragooned into fighting for injustice, those who find themselves deployed to the front to fight against foes in wars of aggression that are unjust. Men, and in some countries women also, who want to seek peace and yet are forced to fight. But is there more that can be said? Is there more that needs to be said? The answer, of course, is absolutely. You see, the horror of war is absolutely horrible. Sometimes it's visible. Sometimes we see it in some of us, the closest we get to it is the films. And watching films often is jarring enough. But that is not the last word. It's not even the loudest word. Because the God who created heaven and earth, who speaks and who has spoken, and who promises to continue to speak, has spoken a clearer word, a more faithful word. He offers a promise to both the present and the future, or for, I should say, the present and the future. And we've heard elements of those promises in our readings. The first one with Malachi is a promise for the future. It's a promise that all evil will end, that justice will be served, that every evildoer will no longer be able to practice the schemes of their hearts. They will not be able to plot in cabinet rooms and state rooms about inflicting violence for a fake and vain glory. They will not be able to use the cover of battle to inflict cruelty on men, women, and children. They will be but stubble. The Lord Almighty talks of a terrible day for these people, but a day of justice, a day when not a root or branch of evil will be left. If you were to come round to my house and you were to look into the back garden, you wouldn't need to get very close to it to realise I am not a gardener. There's no point claiming that which we are not. Green fingers I have not. And yet, this morning at our 9 o'clock Eucharist, as I talked about this illustration, there were a couple of smiles from people that know far better firsthand than I. When you're a gardener, you think sometimes that you've got rid of a weed. Everything comes up and out, and it's a job well done. And yet, as the season cycle and spring returns, what else comes back? The plant that you thought you'd got. In this world, in this moment, evil is like the plant that we think that we got. There are moments of peace that then evil returns and war returns. And yet, on the final day, every root will be got, every branch will be taken, evil will be no more. Friends, that is a promise that has been spoken from the Creator of heaven and earth, the one who created everything that you can see. But it's better than that. It's not just simply that evil will not be allowed to echo, it's that healing will come, because it also says, but for those who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. That's verse 2. And it's very easy when you think of rays of the sun, perhaps to think of when you go on a holiday and you sort of sit on the beach, you venture into it to get your vitamin D boost, to get the perk of emotion and a little bit of health. Friends, if that's all it was, that'd be all right. But the sun brings healing, not simply through the heat, but also through the light. Because on the last day, we will see God face to face, and we will see and know the truth of who we are more deeply than right now we can imagine. For everyone who chooses to revere the name of God, this life is as bad as it gets. However bad your life's been, however bad your life will be, if, and there are some of us younger than others, I hasten to point out slightly, some of us, yeah, I know, you and me looking at each other, it's just you, my friend. I think I'm too old to be conscripted now. But if some of us end up on the battle lines, this promise will hold true. But what is it to revere his name? What is it to to receive healing? It's very simple. It's to respect and it's to love God and all that he's done. It's to put into practice everything he calls us to do, because he's God. That's why he goes on to say in verse 4 to remember what he said to Moses at Mount Horeb. To revere God is to follow him rather than follow the devices and the desires of our own hearts, the battle drums and the clarion call of hatred. And if that was all it was, if that was all that was promised, friends, I'd say that's enough, wouldn't you? If the promise was sufficient that whatever happens here will be reset with healing in eternity, I would say, what a glorious and wonderful God we have. But we shouldn't sell God short. We shouldn't erase the promise for the present. Because, as David read, there is a promise for the present. There is a promise that we can experience a peace that comes from God, not that's manufactured in boardrooms and in staterooms. The Treaty of Versailles was a fleeting peace. It ultimately led to war. But the peace that comes from God is a peace that lasts. And it's true in war and in peace, loss and gain, sickness and health. It's a peace that is given as a gift, but it's a gift that we've got to receive. It's not a gift we have to wait for, however. You don't have to wait till the day you die to receive the peace that is offered. And this morning, I just want to run through very quickly the four things that go into receiving this peace. These verses are rich. They are absolutely splendid. And this morning, I'm not going to go into them in depth. Instead, if you imagine you are currently sitting in a very cultured restaurant, the waiter has come round and he's offered the selection of wines. And you say, I've just got a little bit of a smell, a little bit of a taste of what it is. Not so that you can give it back, but so in your own time you can drink the whole bottle. So here it is. How do we receive the peace that comes from God? The first is in verse 4, to rejoice. And you might say, how can we rejoice? Well, think about it. Think about what God is offering and who he is. There are moments of darkness. Right now there are people in trenches in the world, and yet they are being told to rejoice always. And the reason is that in Christ there are greater promises. That no bullet can extinguish, no horror can steal. Not only do we have the promise of Malachi in the world to come, we have the promise of the cross in the present. Because God did not see fit to stay out of human suffering, but enter in to be with us, to experience death. And as he died, what happened next? Why are we here? People die all the time. We're here because he rose from the dead. But we're here because he is risen and because he offers peace. And he doesn't offer it generally. He offers it personally to you. And so you can rejoice. You can rejoice because this is as bad as it gets. The second thing, however, is perhaps perplexing. He says, don't be anxious, but pray with thanksgiving. Now, I don't know about you, but I've had moments in my life where anxiety has felt like the only possible emotion. I've had moments in my life where anxiety felt like it was going to punch through the bottom of my throat and just engulf my heart and my mind. And in those moments, Jesus says, do not be anxious. Not because you can try some app on your phone or some Zen technique or so that you can basically ignore reality, but so that you can look at reality and then look to God. Because the next thing is, don't be anxious, but in everything, pray with thanksgiving and supplication. Focus on the good. When you're doing this, pray with thanksgiving. This is the third point. When things get bad, don't we allow the darkness to edit light? Don't we allow ourselves to focus on the things that rob us of joy? Focus on the good, Paul says. And finally, we come back to verse 9. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in Paul's life, practice them. In other words, remember what God said on the Mount Horeb. Blessing is not automatic. Peace is not automatic. But the promise for peace, for those that will receive it, is cast iron. It is far more real than any darkness that you currently feel, any anxiety that you currently are escaping from in this moment as you sit in church. Will there be wars in the future? Yes, there will. Will men and will women be harmed and damaged by them? The painful truth is that will happen. May we as England, as Great Britain, may we find ourselves once more at war? The pattern of history suggests quite possibly. And I'm not saying imminently, I'm saying it's a possibility. is true and what is sure and what is good is that whatever trial we enter, personal or national, the promises of Malachi, the promises of Philippians, the promise that there will be a day of justice, there will be a day of healing, and until that day there is opportunity for peace, is more certain than any bullet, more certain than any worry, because Jesus lives, and Jesus offers peace in the darkness as we wait to meet him face to face as the light. Amen. It is for that reason that we should not put our hopes in princes and prime ministers, but in the Creator of heaven and earth, the one who has offered healing and redemption and peace. Let us stand to sing of the only true hope, our hope that is found on God alone. Responsibility of government.
Thanks be to God.
For those who serve in the armed forces of the Crown on sea, land, and in the air.
Thanks be to God.
For doctors, nurses, chaplains, and all who minister to those in need or distress.
Thanks be to God.
For the sacrifices made, especially in two world wars, whereby our peace has been preserved.
Thanks be to God.
pray for all who suffer as a result of war, for the injured and the disabled, for the mentally distressed, and for those whose faith in God and in mankind has been weakened or destroyed, for the homeless and refugees, for those who are hungry, and for all who have lost their livelihood and security, for those who mourn their dead, those who have lost husband or wife, children or parents, and especially for those who have no hope in Christ to sustain them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you comforted your disciples when you were going to die. Now set our troubled hearts at rest and banish our fears. You are the way to the Father. Help us to follow you. You are the truth. Bring us to know you. You are the life. Give us that life to live with you now and forever. Amen. We now stand to sing a hymn which, if memory serves me correct, was sung at the burial of the unknown soldier. Nobody in this world is unknown to our Heavenly Father. Nobody is nameless to Christ. For those who pray and sing in faith, the prayers of this hymn will be answered. Let us stand to sing goodbye with me.
Thank you.
to be seated. We come to this part of our service when we perform that debt of honour and thanks that I spoke about in the sermon. I'm going to invite Jeff to come forward to lead us through this. Jeff is a man who's served in our armed forces, so it felt appropriate to invite him to come. Thank you, Jeff.
Words I'd like to say before we actually start the act of remembrance. And this is not an advert for the Royal British Legion, by the way. The Royal British Legion reminds us that the act of remembrance is brief and non-religious. It's well suited to personalised commemoration, which is what I will do in a moment. So I'm taking this opportunity to ask you, during the 2 minute silence, to remember also those who survived the wars but suffered mental and physical illnesses, including the effect it had on their families. The exhortation and Kahima epitaphs focuses on the fallen and does not mention the survivors. When the act of remembrance was first introduced, post-traumatic stress disorders, which I believe is now called PTSD, were not recognised as they are today. Our concept of war and how it affects us was changed beyond all recognition. And following on from what Father David said earlier in his address, I would like to just briefly go over my experience. You won't believe it, but I was a war baby. And for some reason I've written my notes Second World War, just in case you thought it was the First World War. Now looking round, I think I'm not the only one in this congregation who could describe themselves as a war baby. My father, after many years as a German prisoner of war, was liberated by the American forces and somehow managed to catch a lift from Paris to Croydon Airport immediately. Having been a prisoner for that long, I think he knew all the ways of getting things done. There, in this country, they didn't know what to do with him. He was almost the first liberated prisoner of war to make it to Blighty. I don't think anybody expected somebody to turn up quite so quickly. But the British Army gave him a very good rehabilitation. I don't mean that. The rehabilitation lasted a couple of days, concentrated on reintroducing him to eat English food, very important because of the diet he'd been on, fitting him out in a new uniform. He had to look smart before he came back to me. And then sending him home to his wife. I was born after he had been captured. And in fact, I'm sure I've told some of you that the first telegram that went to him was written by my grandmother, who, bless her, was not too good at putting words together. And my father thought he had a daughter. So my mother sent out another telegram. Bear in mind, if you can remember the telegrams, they used to block out a lot of the information so that we didn't give away secrets to the Germans. My mother sent another one saying, "You've got a son." Unfortunately, the deletions that had been made by security, by the army, made it look as if I was now twins. So my mother then sent out another telegram saying that he only had a son, and I don't think he ever got over that, because I think he rather preferred a daughter at the time. I was playing in the street, was three and a half. And the chap in a very smart uniform came up and said, "Where does Mr. Draper live?" And I said, "Up there." Because we were in a block of flats. I wasn't pointing up there, I was pointing up there. And off he went. He didn't know I was his son, and I didn't know he was my father. I can still remember that time, even though I was only three and a half at the time. For many years, he did not speak about the war, hoping that memories would go away. When times are difficult, sorry about this. My mother took me aside and said, he was not the man she married. There was no reflection on him or her. It was her way of telling me that the war, of what the war had done to him. I use this personal story to remind you, to remind us that war affects everybody. So during your reflections, during the 2 minute silence, please remember all those affected. So now we are having the actual last post a little bit early because in no way my story would have been another 20 minutes. So. If I could ask you to stand now and we'll go into the act of remembrance. Once I found the right tones. Let us remember before God and commend him his sure keeping. Those who have died for their country in war, those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of humanity.
Thank you.
when you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today.
Ever-living God, in humility we remember those whom you've gathered from the storm of war into the peace of your presence. May that same peace calm our fears, bring justice to all peoples, establish harmony among the nations, and bring peace and healing to those affected by war. Wives, children, families, to those who survive and yet bear the scars, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And so as we seek to revere the name of the Lord, let us pledge ourselves anew to the service of God and our fellow man, that we may be peacemakers in our homes, in our community, in our country, and in our world. Let us pray together. Lord God, we pledge ourselves to serve you and all mankind in the cause of peace, and for the relief of want and of suffering. Give us wisdom, give us courage, give us hope, and keep us always faithful. Amen. Before we come to the blessing, we have our final prayer, of course, set to music, the national anthem, as we pray that God would save our gracious King Charles. Work out how you put it in your diary as you buy the tickets and then write it in your diary. We have raffle tickets going to be available on the night, which means there'll be raffle prizes. We already have quite a few, but if you want to add to that to increase the chance of the celebration of coming, hearing great music, and then winning the beers that the vicar, well, the priest in charge will supply, I promise you I have good taste. So raffle tickets and raffle prizes also. We hopefully will be having other Christmas events, so watch this space. But until those are announced, can I just say, teas and coffees are available in the hall as usual, and then tonight, this afternoon at 4 o'clock, we have a time of quiet prayer. And for those of you who are skedaddling quickly because a certain team is hoped to win at home, can I say bless you? Let us stand for the blessing for everybody though, shall we? So, go from here in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honour everyone. Love and serve the Lord your Saviour, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you.